Hello. How are you? As you heard a moment ago, if you were in here, I'm Matthew White from PlayStation, and I'm a data analyst there. The title varies everywhere.
I'm Jenny Tremaine. I'm a user experience researcher at Sony PlayStation, and I work with Matt.
So what we're going to talk about today, and what I'd really like to do, and hopefully if you're in this room, you have some interest in something related to behavioral data, and also, obviously, user research. There's a lot of analytics work that goes on at PlayStation. Much of it is monetary and focused on sales and ARPU and a lot of letters. We made a joke last month, ARPMAL is a thing now. So we call that the communist dog bark. You can send your complaints to David Tisserand, wherever he is. So what I'd like to do is talk about user behavior data, specifically how we mine what people are doing in the game and the things they're actually engaging with, and how you work with your user research team to work together to try to overcome problems that might otherwise be impossible without computational intervention. And hopefully, Jenny can chime in with ways that data has helped or hindered her work, and I can do the same.
It helps. So,
yeah, good. Yeah. What I'd like to do, though, is this is a fishbowl session. So what I'd like to do is I'm going to put you there and me here, and I would like to get three other people to come up here who have worked or work with a quantitative, qualitative, triangulation metric in some capacity, or just want to talk, and come on up and sit, and we'll follow the fishbowl fashion. So when one of us stops talking, you trade the mic off. So we'll start up with a question, and I'm going to talk about sort of an example from recent memory, and I guess Jenny can start it off, and when we start talking, get up here, please.
Want me to give an example?
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. So an example that we've worked together recently is how kind of our work has helped Matt's drive what we should do with analytics. So we're doing user testing on a game that's in development. You don't have the analytic hooks or the things. You're not even sure what you want to track once the game is released. And so in our tests, things that we're looking at, like the behaviors that we're measuring in our studies, that we as researchers are interested or that the teams are interested, that helps drive what we want to track in the future. And it also helps us out a lot because in the beginning, a lot of times we're counting button presses and that is not fun and it's not a great use of our time. So we can work together to help develop what we need for the future.
Yeah, these are analytics low-hanging fruit. When I showed up, there were people literally with clickers, and there'd be one person assigned to each function in the game. It's like when they die, you click. When they respawn, you click. And like, so these are the obvious, analytic help. We can put those kinds of things in. They're emitted to a server, and I can give you a count immediately after the test is over, or even real time during the test, to not waste a human pushing a button. There's a lot of two-way gain actually. So when a user test is being done, a member of our analytics team, whether that's me or one of the other four or five people we employ, will often go and sit and watch in and start counting action verbs that are trackable. We'll look in at a user test and say, okay, this is a new feature they put in. It can have this analytic parameter attached to it, which can be emitted and sent back to the user research team. And that back and forth collaboration helps us to build really robust data sets that we can find extremely interesting little behavioral clusters in after the fact. I still have empty seats. James Berg, ladies and gentlemen.
Well, if no one else is going to yell, I'll always do it. There, thank you, Nick.
Nick Van Meerten. Nick Van Meerten, ladies and gentlemen.
So an example of kind of a really good collaboration, I'm going to say something nice for a change. On the Mirror's Edge Catalyst project that I worked on at EDA, working with the DICE Studio, I had a really good analytics person, much like Matt, But she was basically like, I was able to look and say, like, this is what I'm observing. This is why players are falling off buildings and dying. This is why players are getting their butts kicked in combat. And I could give them the why. What I could not do for a room full of 24 people is employ a small army of people with clickers. Or like even just, I did not have the ability to track that telemetry. And she was able to just be like, great, give me their account names. Here's your report. And I was like, that took you 7 minutes. I lost more sleep worrying about that than it took you to do the work. Like you said, like low hanging fruit like that, for you guys, super easy. For us, life changing. Yeah. Like the depth and the richness of the research that I was able to get because of that was incredible. Like, if you have anyone in your organization or your team that is resistant in any way to that, reach out to people that have done this and we will just yell at them for you. Just put us on the phone and we'll just scream that they need to do this. Or be nice.
I mean, there's tons of examples where I'm just like, hey, I wonder what this is, or I wonder, you know, why, how many people do this thing? And I'll just shoot questions over to Matt and he will just give me a data dump in hours. And that's
seconds sometimes, but yeah, usually hours. Yeah. 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 Don't, I like to, I think this is the thing where you make sure you set the expectation that I can't normally do this in seconds. Carry on.
So I'm usually working as a consultant. My name is Nick Van Meerten. I work in Minnesota mostly, and there's a lot of independent developers or smaller studios that don't necessarily have an embedded research team. So I've worked with a lot of them to get Unity Analytics set up, which is currently in beta, but it works very well. And a lot of embedded dashboards on their website that make it much easier for the like indie developer to access their data. So that's what I've worked on a lot with data in games.
That's great.
So yeah, I'm Pejman from Execution Lab. I do the user research part of all for all our studios. One of the best things that happened to me was being the kind of my desk is the near our analytics person's desk. So we had to do loads of collaboration, which was awesome. One thing, and we focus on indie developers. So we have like 20 studios that we work with. And one thing that we learned very quickly is how much combining the both can save our own resources. For example, if I'm analyzing observation data, it can take me lots of time rewatching them. But my analytics partner could tell me that, go watch level 3. That's where all the problems are happening. Saved me loads of time. There was loads of stuff that I missed, but she would pick them up and said, can you tell me what happened to player 4 at this moment? And I could do that. One thing that we developed a kind of our own dashboard for our studios. And we use analytics in playtesting with a super fast turnaround. So like few minutes after I finish a playtest, I could get a quick analytics report on the main issues that we had. And I could include that in my interview or focus group, and that was awesome. So you all should do that.
I'm happy to hear it. One thing I'd like to do is lead with a little probe question too. We have clearly a lot of positive experiences integrating these two things together. As I mean, anybody that's done any research of any kind knows that some kind of data triangulation gives you multiple ways to look at a complex issue. But one of the things we run into from time to time is that implicitly developers will trust quantitative metrics or qualitative metrics more than the other. And they sort of believe that maybe there's validity in numbers and small sample sizes don't work, or they believe that numbers are kind of soulless and that they're not real players and they don't represent a real experience. So I'm also interested in hearing about, and as a, I don't know, you can definitely, but I do want to hear about any experiences you guys have, and even after this talk, in navigating that kind of developer expectation and how sort of knowing a little bit can be a dangerous thing. So carry on.
Hello, my name is Mark Bergman. I just started at Blizzard. So I'm one of these rare birds that's actually a combination user researcher and data scientist. So in my particular world, what I've usually seen is that I have a PhD, so I have a background. I've done qual-quant type of research. Is that the questions you ask and the data you want to get and the results you want to get is usually across a group of different people who may or may not ever talk to each other or even understand each other. So a lot of what I do is I work that whole, I'm going to use the term holistic cycle of research, which is, what are the questions we're trying to get? Okay, how are we going to measure it? Okay, how are we going to get that data? How are we going to store it? How are we going to analyze it? So I worry about the whole supply chain. So to get back to what you're saying, can you measure it? Can you store it? Can you analyze it? Are there things you're going to do with it? Like, a lot of things I want to do is take the data we're getting from this and shove it into AI engines and ML engines and see what they do with it. A lot of what I want to do with it is actually get better questions. So my view is that combining the two is actually more powerful than either of the two by themselves.
Well spoken, yeah, for sure.
But also managing expectations of what you should be answering with data at all times is good. Like, I've had a lot of, as soon as somebody gets access to data, a lot of the time they have so many questions that pop into their head and they want to answer all of them right away. And trying to refine what are the important questions is like the first step that I've always had to take.
Yeah, this is wonderful. This is an area that in my experience, user researchers are much better at than I have ever been, because user researchers have to work in parsimony, right? Like, you only have people for so many hours a day, and survey fatigue is a real thing, and interview fatigue is a real thing. And so very good at getting to the nuggets of data that are very, very useful. Whereas in the work I do now, it's much more a complete broad stroke approach. I mean, I have terabytes of user data that somewhere in there is something valuable, maybe. So it's a very different kind of down-up approach.
Well, I just wanted to, first, I'm Morgan Kennedy. I'm a user research manager at Compulsion Games, working on a game called We Happy Few for the Xbox and PC. And for about 5 years, I was user researcher at Ubisoft Montreal with many people that are here today, mostly working on Assassin's Creed. But I'm not sure if this is also supposed to be a combative panel, but I thought I'd push back a little bit. So this doesn't turn into like a love festival, basically.
No, absolutely. I definitely, but, yeah. We need angry people. I thought that was going to be James Byrd, but he surprised us all.
Okay, well, I'll just say, this is, I guess, my personal and professional opinion, is when you have very, very early stage when, tracking is either partly or not even implemented at all, and also when you're working with very early builds, and I'll stand by this, that I actually think the person with the clicker can sometimes provide a more accurate count or even... numerical values for things like times and deaths, things like length of complete missions, just because for all their strengths, I think that, computers are still not very good for understanding context, right? Did the player mean to do that? Were they asked a question so they turned around, looked away from the screen, things like that. So.
Yeah, absolutely. There's danger in data. And I mean, this is a conversation that I've had a million times in many different employments, in that, a number can sometimes do more damage than it. In a now notorious, I don't see any of my fellow Volitionites around, but in a now notorious issue that persists from a previous job, I had someone miscalculated just a simple like division error, a number of people using a particular much loved community feature in a game that I can't mention, reported that to the studio, and that number stuck, and it was wrong. And I mean, simple math error wrong. But by the time that got out the door, it took us years to extricate that from people's minds. So sometimes people believe in an absoluteness in numbers that is not reality. And unfortunately, they tend to run with a percentage or a to the bank.
Sometimes that's
a short run.
That's something that we've experienced together as well, where if I ask a question, I want to know a piece of information. We're working on MLB The Show at the San Diego studio. And I had a question about seasons played, and that brought up a big error in the way that this was being calculated on the analytics side. And so without because it influenced my research question, without that we wouldn't have known, we would have been presenting in an incorrect data back to the studio.
Yeah, to your point, it's interesting sometimes because that does cause landmines in your data. We very much, it's a big game. It's one played by millions and millions of people. And we had developers that were in panic mode because it appeared like maybe 1,000, 2,000 people had seen this feature we put millions of dollars into. But it was an analytics reporting error that we had to trace down. Super interesting. But these are the things we never let out into the wild for that reason, right?
Just to kind of follow up that point, one of the things I like to do is actually work with the designers, work with anybody in the organization to know how to ask questions that we can answer. There is an invisible communication as to who we are, what we do, and what we can actually respond with. And so by the time we respond, they don't know what the heck we're talking about. So that type of communication also is really incumbent upon not just what the user research is going to do, but how you're going to see the answer, how you're going to deal with the answer. If it's going to be a narrative, fine. Show me that it's going to be a narrative. If it's going to be a storyboard, fine. If it's going to be numbers and the narrative, but that's the point. A lot of time people don't even understand what they can get, what they could understand. So I think that's incumbent also upon us to be able to take that extra step.
And this also goes back to the previous panel as well, but I think maybe an interesting way to tell how well we're doing is how much of it is push and how much of it is pull. Like, how much are they asking for data and how much are we pushing it?
Absolutely. Yeah. Just one other part. I'm Tom from Xbox. So one other part for the kind of the love fest and the good examples that we don't often talk about is the recruiting side. So I love working with our telemetry and our big data and our data scientist folks. And I'm always telling people they're just fantastic with our recruiting, either because we can use our 1 million person insider program to recruit like the 10 people who use this feature, right? That I wouldn't be able to get at a survey. And the flip side is I am doing a survey for recruiting. I don't have to ask 100 questions about how many hours they've played, what kind of games they played. So it's really that dual purpose. We love them for a million other reasons, and we do a lot of the stuff you guys are talking about. But that idea of like, I just need 100 people who have played a tournament, which is a beta feature. Or if I talk to 100 people, I don't want to ask them every single question about their gameplay, right? So our UR studies have become much more powerful through recruiting on both those ways.
Yeah, that's interesting. You had me try to pinpoint second language users and put them in geographic locations so that you could recruit specifically for those people. So yeah, we definitely are into that as well. And yeah, I think that's a powerful combination. I'll lay one more probing question and let that kind of sit. One of the things we've gotten into more recently is to give developers access to the content that we're both doing. You know, traditional research reports are always helpful, and that's kind of the bread and butter of our industry. But with the data side background, we also provide live updating sort of metrics and analytics to the games, so people can see at any given moment what feature is being used, what map is most popular, etc. I'm sure there are opinions about what should and should not be in those things, or if they're a good idea at all, because of course there is the perception that maybe not telling people sometimes is a smarter thing than telling people. So I'd love to have a conversation about that as well, if anybody has anything interesting to say. Carry on.
Well, to that point, I think some of the problem can be is if you look at like a funnel, for example. So, you know, when are people falling off, and if you see a huge drop off at one certain point, you don't know that there's nothing in that data to tell you why it's happening. And so that's why you need these smaller scales. You need to get in deeper with people and figure out the why.
I'm Molly Sirota, PlayStation. There was a test that we were running where one of the activities we had users do was to locate the marketplace, buy something. And in this test, the majority of our users failed at finding the marketplace. They never made it there, therefore they never purchased anything. And the telemetry data that we were looking at does not show that. It shows that 80% of our users on the first time of visiting this particular mode would visit the marketplace within that same setting. So then the argument could first be that the user research data is not reliable. And it just changes the story is all. We just had to go back to the team and say, hey, look, you're doing really well with getting people to the marketplace. It's successful at an 80% level. What we saw in this test is that there's room for improvement. It just changes the story by having both the user test research behind it and the quantitative statistical data to show how serious is the problem that we saw in the research study.
Yeah, I think that brings up a really great point. So kind of on the negative side, as much as I love our quantitative folks, they will often put up those numbers and say 80%, but not say whether they think that's good or not, right? So 80% may be fantastic, and often in telemetry it is, but how about the 5% or the 10%? So it's often in a room where you see the dashboards, and then you said maybe you shouldn't show people. I'm all for showing them all the dashboards as long as you have sort of the goal or the prediction. Like, here's the line we want to be at, but showing somebody that something's at 5%, they may panic, even though 5% is awesome, or showing it's 90% may be terrible if it's turning on the box, right? But I would love to have more of the quant folks draw that line and not just say, oh, well, this is what we're reporting on, right?
So dashboards during development have caused some of my more stressful days, because I've had, like, you know, our quant person, fantastic, you know, they will set up a dashboard that tracks all the stuff coming out of the playtest stuff. And then, you know, I get an email during the playtest from some poor designer who's watching it and doesn't realize, like, there's a bug in the game where, like, this thing just doesn't work and something spikes. And they're just losing their minds because we've taught them that this is important, you should be watching this, and they listened. And then all of a sudden they're like, oh my God, why is this going on? Why is this going on? And you just be like, I have no idea why that's going on. I don't understand why that would happen. Then I have to go back and figure out, like, okay, why is that telemetry doing that, yada, yada. So post-launch, I understand why that totally makes sense. Give them access to all the data. But in development, I really want a gatekeeper who can interpolate that data in a meaningful way.
No, I totally agree. We have interesting problems like this all the time. No, you're full of crap, James. What are you doing? We have this problem occasionally. There was a time at a different company where we were trying to pilot a tool where individual developers, and this, you can crucify me for this, you would be able to grab a particular gameplay meme, like an item you can do in the game, like shot an enemy or stole a car or whatever, and a particular other thing, and drag them live and see how they correlated to each other over time. So...
Why?
Right, and that is the question, right? So the idea, original idea at the time, and we scrapped this, literally because of that, we did not ship. This was Volition. It didn't ship. But the original reason was, theoretically, gameplay combat designers want to know how to pace enemy encounters and procedural content. So they want to give weightings to the kinds of enemies that appear when you do this thing, or the kinds of, you get the idea. You know, if when I'm in a car, I really enjoy running over this particular pedestrian, well, hey, let's spawn more of them. Like, I mean, give people what they want in a procedural sense. But, unfortunately, what that led to is a lot of sort of, like, I pretty much know which features shouldn't be in this game anymore now because this box told me so. And yeah, unfortunately, leaving those in the wild is not necessarily the smartest choice I've ever made. But here we are.
Hi, I'm Daniel Narapov from Ubisoft Toronto. I'm here to pick a fight. The thing about like reports versus dashboards, right? Reports, in theory, they're not raw data. They're raw data which went through an analyst or an expert's hand, and they distilled it into insights and results and shared it with the team. Dashboards, I think, the thing which scares me about dashboards is in some way they're just raw data, and if we make that available to everybody, then one thing is we're missing context, right? If I give telemetry data to a UX analyst who also has observations and also has questionnaires and also has interviews, they have the context, they don't have that. But I think it's also like there is a learned skill about how to interpret data. So like, an anecdote which somebody else told me is they were working on an open world game, and they had a bunch of dashboards exposed to the team, and somebody from the team went through and found that like the number of deaths from falling damage, like falling off a mountain to your death, was much higher in one region than other regions, and then sent an email to the team and basically said like, this, you know, mountains here are very dangerous, we need to tone them down and change a bunch of geography. It turns out that the thing they weren't looking at was time spent per region. So there were much more deaths in this region, but actually there was much more time spent in this region. So if you're actually looking at the game world as a whole, rookie mistake, turns out this isn't the area you should be fixing, it's totally fine. So I think like, I would expect that level of rigor from an analyst, I won't expect that level of rigor from a guy who's scrolling through dashboards.
Yeah, and I think that's entirely fair. I think the natural counter to a dashboard is, you know, how do we gatekeep a little bit some of that? So we're getting better at this, and I mean, I definitely want to hear interesting solutions at any time, email me. But we've gotten better. We have some good engineers that have programmed in kind of, and this is so far beyond me, but things that effectively check for errors before they get published. So that like, if there is some really super insane spike or change or a predictable pattern that changes dramatically, we'll receive like an email before it publishes. And it's kind of like, hey, did DAU literally go to zero today? Because I'm not sure I want to tell the studio that from the, like the dashboarding system before it goes out. Yeah, we're working on a system to do that now, actually. And that's been really promising. Because you're right, like some of these wild numbers are not necessarily good.
I think there's different error. There's different causes for like wrong conclusions, right? One is we have a bug in tracking and we can fix that, right? One is I lack context and maybe we can fix that. But the other one is this isn't my job or my expertise. And like, in the same way that I wouldn't want to expose like raw telemetry data, I probably also wouldn't want to expose like raw questionnaire qualitative numbers, right? I want somebody who knows what they're doing to look at them first, kind of thing.
Sure.
But I mean, again, like, I don't think it's a bad thing. I think like I'm treating that data in the same way I treat any other data source, right? Where like the dashboard should be in the hands of people who are able to integrate it into their conclusions and generate insights, which is when it becomes a happy love story, as opposed to like, you know, we have a report, but also here is every raw comment that every player wrote in our questionnaire, and that's terrifying. Yeah.
You know, that's always been a back and forth for me that I've never really truly learned to balance, because unfortunately, the certain little minutiae of like statistics and how you run the numbers change the way it looks a lot of the time, right? Like, so for example, if we're looking at weightings in a, you know, we're working on Drawn to Death. That one's public. Yeah, okay, good. I was like, am I going to get fired? No, we're good. So we're working on Drawn to Death, which is public announced. You know, and they're curious about balancing. It's like a hero shooter kind of deal. They're looking at balancing the different characters, right? So one thing the designers really love, and this is a tool dashboard that we give them all the time, is a matrix, right, across the kinds of characters this way, the kinds of weapons this way, and like the kill-death ratio for all of those combinations. So you can see like at a glance, like, oh crap, that's a really unbalanced combo, things like that. However, you know, whether you average that or you like do like clusters on it, or whether you use like quartiles, changes whether it looks balanced or imbalanced. And unfortunately, the vast majority of the combat designers don't care about that level of like mathematical nuance. So I'm always, maybe I'm just an anxious person, but I'm always like, well, but be careful with that because it might not really mean what you think it does. And it, what's that?
That team loves raw data.
I was going to stop talking about my own panel. Sorry,
well, that team loves raw data. Like they want our raw results from surveys as well. And I'm always either say no or very hesitant or will give them numbers, but have to give the caveat on don't interpret it this way. You know, this is what we can learn from it, but here's what we shouldn't conclude as well.
Yeah, I'm a hard no on like the team asks me for, hey, can I get the data from that? I'm just like, nope. If you have a question, I haven't done my job properly. Tell me your question. Let me sit down and talk with you and we'll figure that out. But I've just been bitten too many times by giving the team raw data that I know how to interpolate and understand the context with. And then I talk to the team that I gave the raw data to, and like they don't understand like distribution, you know. So they're looking at stuff, and they're like, "Well, okay, these two are the same." And I'm like, "Well, no, this has a 3.1 of the standard deviation of like, you know, past my bar graph, and this one has a standard deviation of like 0.7, right? Like these are not the same. They just don't understand that. So raw data, if it's qualitative, okay, but raw numbers, no, especially with smaller sample sizes."
I mean, I think just to temper a little bit, right? I think I am, that being said, I am a believer in like empowering groups or individuals to pursue those dashboards, right? So, hey, we have a dashboard for I don't know what. I probably don't love sharing it with 400 people and saying good luck, but I do like saying like, you don't need me to be a bottleneck every single time you want to look at a system you're working on. Sure. So, hey, three game designers, here's what it means. Here's how it works. Here are some things you shouldn't be doing, but now you're empowered and you're trained and you can kind of, you know, you're a power user in some sense and you can kind of peruse that dashboard as opposed to, is that okay? Isabel is so judging me.
Do they ever share that information out in a way that they shouldn't though? That's always what I'm afraid of. Like, you understand it as a designer, but then do they share that with people that don't understand?
I mean, I think yes. I guess it's like, at this point it's like a bit theoretical and would and should and could. I think I would basically say that at that point you should be sharing conclusions, and I trust your conclusions because I've trained you or empowered you to use them, as opposed to you just take a screenshot of the dashboard and go like, 300 people.
I have a probing question. So me and Matt, we work pretty well together, I would say. But does anyone else have any tips or tricks or things that they've encountered to work better, to have these two teams, like a data team and a research team, work better together?
Pizza?
Alcohol. Food? Booze?
I'm already sitting here. You guys need way more time than I do. And you guys have way more dependencies on, like, you need people to put telemetry hooks into the game. They then need to be tested. Then you need to create a dashboard. And I'm like, hey, I have a playtest in 2 weeks. I need this thing hooked up. And all I get back is laughter. I'm like, oh, okay. Okay, I have a playtest in 12 weeks. And now it's down to Snickers. I'm like, okay, maybe they can make that happen. So if you want your quants to do something right, give them the time to do it. And respect the fact that it's going to take them a lot of time.
Yeah, to respond, I mean, a lot of the time, unfortunately, our work comes up against like build cycles, like, right, because I mean, a lot of the time I have to literally touch the engine and put in code and hooks and things that are not there, and that can feasibly break something. You know, we're working with a lot of VR games now, and like the frame rate requirements are so high on PlayStation, especially because, you know, you're working with a console and not a supercomputer. That, you know, asking them to put in another telemetry emitter is sometimes extremely taxing. And yeah, there's often a humongous engineering bottleneck for that. Actually, I think that's three, to be honest. But anyway, thank you very much, everyone, and enjoy the rest of the afternoon.